Imagine a single uranium fuel rod generating enough heat to power 1 million kilowatt hours of electricity, which is equivalent to the annual energy consumption of approximately 100 homes. Ever wondered how such a potent energy source is created? How is enriched uranium extracted and processed into a fuel that powers our world? In this video, we'll take you behind the scenes to explore these questions and more. We visited the largest high-quality uranium deposit in the world and a nuclear fuel factory to discover how uranium is extracted from nature and how one of the Earth's most dangerous metals is processed. Uranium, a metallic element first discovered by a German chemist in 1789, held a secret that wouldn't be unveiled for another century and a half. It wasn't until 1938 that scientists realized uranium atoms could be split to release an incredible amount of energy. This groundbreaking discovery set the stage for harnessing nuclear power, transforming our approach to energy production. To obtain uranium, mining operations dig 500 meters underground in northern Saskatchewan, a province in western Canada renowned for its vast and rich uranium deposits. This region is home to the world's largest and highest quality uranium source. The uranium extracted here is mainly used as fuel in nuclear reactors, playing a crucial role in electricity generation. The uranium ore is located beneath a layer of water-saturated sandstone. To access it, mining operations use tungsten carbide drills that work like knuckles punching through the rock face. These initial drill holes are used to insert tubes that will extract heat from the ground and freeze it around the ore. The miner operates the equipment remotely and transfers a new piece of tubing to the end of the drill every meter and a half. Drilling 130 meters into the sandstone can take up to 8 days to complete just one length of tubing, and there are 200 tubes in total. These freezing tubes not only stabilize the ground, but also convert high-pressure groundwater into ice, preventing it from interfering with the mining process. An above-ground freezing plant cools calcium chloride brine to minus 30 degrees Celsius, which is then circulated through the freezing tubes. This brine absorbs heat as it freezes the ground and subsequently cools down again above the uranium deposits. With the ground now stabilized, the extraction process can begin. The mining team will use a drill to penetrate the ore body and create a small diameter hole known as a pilot hole. This pilot hole maps out the route for the drill to reach the ore and provides an entry point for larger mining equipment. From an elevated position, the drill vertically penetrates the rock to reach a precise level beneath the ore body. Next, they prepare for the expansion drill. This drill inserts an expansion bit through the pilot hole, enlarging the rock to access the uranium ore. The remote control system ensures that miners remain a safe distance from falling rocks and minimizes their exposure to radioactive uranium. As an added safety measure, the mine is continuously ventilated, with fresh air introduced every 20 minutes. Controlled by the operator's joystick, the cart transports the ore to a scanner. The scanner measures the ore's radioactivity and determines that the uranium content is approximately 15%. In many cases, the uranium content is even higher, averaging around 18%, which is considered exceptionally high quality. The cart then empties the ore into a chute. In the control room, an operator uses a hydraulic hammer to crush the ore into smaller pieces. This crushed ore is sent to a mill, where it is ground into a fine sand. Water is added to create a slurry, which is then pumped to the surface. Trucks transport this uranium slurry to a processing mill located 80 kilometers away, where they stop at a specialized unloading facility. The vacuum system support aligns with the container holding the uranium slurry tank. Once positioned, a vacuum tube is lowered into the tank to suction out the slurry. After washing and a radiation check, the truck departs from the facility. The ore, now in powder form, undergoes treatment with acid to extract the uranium. The uranium slurry is transferred into large tanks filled with acid, which dissolves the uranium but leaves the remaining rock behind. The rock settles at the bottom of the tanks, while the acidic uranium solution flows forward, allowing unwanted minerals to be removed. The uranium is then further purified through a series of chemical reactions. Next, the uranium is heated to 850 degrees Celsius and converted into a gas, which is necessary for enriching uranium-235, the isotope required for creating a chain reaction. This gas is fed into centrifuges, where centrifugal forces are used to separate uranium isotopes based on their mass. Uranium-235, being slightly lighter than uranium-238, tends to concentrate more in the center of the centrifuge, facilitating its separation. Once separated, it forms a black powder similar to coal. This uranium powder is then transferred into 210-liter steel drums, which are sent to a nuclear fuel processing plant. At the plant, the uranium transitions from black to yellow as it is converted into uranium trioxide, an intermediate chemical form in the processing chain. The uranium trioxide is transported in specially designed inverted cones. Upon arrival, a valve at the bottom of the cones opens, allowing the powder to flow into conveyor tubes that lead to the processing plant. Inside the facility, the uranium trioxide powder is dissolved in acid. A worker samples the solution to test its density and chemistry, confirming that both meet required standards. A chemical is then added to convert the dissolved uranium into a solid form. After further processing, uranium trioxide is transformed into uranium dioxide, the chemical form needed for nuclear fuel. By centrifuging the uranium dioxide, particles of different sizes are mixed to produce a more homogeneous blend. The chemical processing has altered the uranium's color to a fine black powder. Using several tons of pressure, presses mold the uranium dioxide into small pellets. A rotating wheel with bumps guides these pellets onto a conveyor channel. Remarkably, a single uranium pellet, about the size of a peanut, produces as much energy as 1,700 pounds of coal or 560 liters of oil. The conveyor transports the pellets to an oven where they are heated for 24 hours. This process removes any pores in the pellets, causing them to contract and thereby increasing the density of the uranium. A robotic arm then loads the pellets into a tray and levels them, preparing them for the next stage in the fuel assembly process. The conveyor moves the tray forward, and a robot places zirconium fuel tubes onto a rack. Zirconium, known for its high resistance to both heat and corrosion, is chosen because it allows neutrons to pass through freely during the fission reaction. The rack of zirconium tubes aligns with the incoming pellet tray. A robotic loader then pushes a stack of 30 pellets into each tube. These tubes, now filled with pellets, are joined together to form fuel assemblies destined for the reactor core. Each tube is passed one by one to an automated welder, which seals the ends. Once the rods are fully welded and the package sealed at both ends, a robot transfers the completed uranium fuel rod to a scale. This scale verifies that the correct amount of uranium is present in the package, ensuring it meets the required specifications before being used in the reactor. Before being used in a reactor, the nuclear fuel rods emit very low levels of radioactivity and are safe to handle while workers prepare them for shipping. Each rod contains enough uranium to provide power to 100 homes for a year. Once delivered to the nuclear plant, the fuel is inserted into the reactor core, where it acts as the trigger for the energy generation process. In the reactor, uranium serves as the initial energy source that is ultimately converted into electricity. Each uranium fuel rod generates enough heat to produce 1 million kilowatt hours of electricity. For the rods to become active, they must be inserted into the reactor core. The reactor contains 480 tubes, each capable of holding up to a dozen fuel rods. Once all 5,760 rods are in place, the nuclear fission process begins. This process converts matter into energy, which is then released as massive amounts of heat, driving the electricity generation. Some of the uranium atoms within these fuel rods are unstable. When these atoms are unstable, they begin to release neutrons in all directions. These small neutrons can penetrate the zirconium walls of the fuel rods, moving from one tube to another until they collide with another uranium atom. Upon collision, the uranium atom splits, releasing energy and additional neutrons, which further perpetuates the chain nuclear reaction. However, if this reaction accelerates too quickly, it needs to be halted to prevent a nuclear reactor meltdown. To ensure safety, the reactor is not only encased in 2-meter-thick reinforced concrete walls, but also equipped with automatic shutdown systems. These systems are designed to halt the reaction if the temperature rises or the pressure drops too rapidly, maintaining the reactor's stability and preventing dangerous situations. The heat generated from nuclear fission is used to convert water into steam, a process precisely controlled from the plant's control room. The steam drives enormous turbines located in a room that stretches 400 meters long and rises 20 stories high. These turbines spin at 1,800 revolutions per minute and drive a generator. The giant wheel of the generator transforms this motion into over 750 megawatts of electricity, enough to power 500,000 homes. After approximately a year in the reactor core, the fuel rods become depleted but are still extremely hot and radioactive. Due to their high temperature, the rods must be stored underwater for 10 years before they can be safely disposed of. They are submerged in a pool at the plant to cool down and allow the radioactivity to diminish. This 8-meter-deep pool houses more than 700,000 spent fuel rods, ensuring their safe and controlled cooling process. If you want to know how microchips are made from sand, watch the video on your screen. Like the video if you have enjoyed it and share it with your friends. Also, subscribe to this channel by activating notifications to continue learning. Thank you for watching.